Good evening and thank you for joining us on What's Hot. I'm Kritika Saxena. Here are the top five stories that we are tracking this evening. Well, it's day one of the World Economic Forum 2019 and the globe's richest and most powerful have congregated at the picturesque town in Davos in Switzerland. Shireen Bhan joins in now from Davos with a very special guest to you. Shireen, over to you.
Tata Steel's TV Narendran, always a pleasure. Thanks very much for joining us. Let me start by asking you about the outlook for 2019, both in terms of demand as well as prices.
Well, demand has been quite okay. Prices have not been so great. That's been happening for the last couple of months. Since November, we've seen a softening of prices by about $100 in the international markets. I think it's driven a bit more by sentiment. There is a lot of concern about what's happening in China. Things slower than people imagined. What is the impact of the trade actions? So we're seeing that play out in the international markets. Otherwise, fundamentally, if you look at demand growth, it's okay. I know the IMF has reduced the forecast for global economic growth, but not so material as to explain why the prices should drop by $100. And so when we look at 2019, we're looking at China growing at 6.5% or so, and India also being quite strong. So these are two major steel-consuming countries. There is a bit of concern about the U.S., whether the second half of 2019 will not be so great for the U.S. So we need to see how that plays out. So demand side, globally, we expect it to be positive. Mm-hmm. China, the World Steel Association, had forecasted zero demand growth for this year. Let's see how it plays out. If it is positive, that's on the upside. India, we expect about 6-7% growth in demand.
Okay. Since we're talking about India, let me ask you about the bets that you've made as far as the Indian market is concerned. And through the IBC process, you picked up Bhushan. Of course, questions on whether you paid too much or not, but I guess the jury's still out on that. What's the outlook as far as that particular acquisition is concerned?
Well, I think we made a good buy. Of course, you can argue whether you paid a bit more or a bit less. It would have been worse if we'd bid a bit less and lost it. So I think we know how difficult it is to build a new greenfield site. It's taken us more than 10 years to get Kalinganagar started. And today Bhushan is producing more than what Kalinganagar has done. Kalinganagar is, of course, expanding. Bhushan is generating more EBITDA than Tata Steel Europe is doing. So if you look at it from that perspective, I think it was a good buy for us. Of course, the steel cycle goes up and down. The prices go up and down. But I think fundamentally it's a good asset. It's a well-built asset, good quality assets. And we think we can run it well. And I think this year we are 4.1, 4.2 levels of production compared to 3.5 last year. Next year, we'll cross 5. So we're on track. So we're quite happy with what we bought.
Mm-hmm. Since you talked about Europe, let me ask you about progress as far as the ThyssenKrupp Tata Steel JV is concerned. You've put up a new management board in place. That announcement was made recently. You know, what's the latest there as far as that business is concerned?
Yeah. Firstly, we call them the designated management board because till the JV is cleared by the Competition Commission, we can't proceed. But there are a number of actions that we need to take anyways, which doesn't conflict with what we are not allowed to do. So that's why we said we'll have the management team. So we have Goss and Desai from Thyssen, and we have Hans and Sandeep from our side. So they're already working. They're meeting every 2 weeks and making the plan for that. As far as the Competition Commission is concerned, there is a conversation which is going on. They've asked us some questions on the packaging steels, on the electrical steels and automotive. I think we've responded. We are waiting for them now to come back to us. Basically, the timeline, officially the timeline was end March, which because in between they had stopped it for some time because they were still seeking some more information. Now, officially, the commission has announced April, but nothing stops us from getting the clearance earlier. I mean, if the commission wants to, they can give us a clearance earlier. So January is a critical month because we've given all the answers that they'd wanted. They need to come back to us and then we will take forward. So I think we are in a crucial stage. Mm-hmm. Things are going as per plan. And let's hope we can complete the formalities by the end of this financial year or as early as possible in the next financial year so that we can move on.
So as and when you do get the CCI approval and you hope that it will be before the April timeline that is put in place, what next? Give me a sense of what the next steps will be.
So we have, like I said, the designated management board. We'll also announce a supervisory board, which is a board which is going to run the company. We have already the what we call the clean teams, the teams who are working on it, who are not allowed to talk to anybody outside of the clean teams. So the preparation is already going on. We know exactly what to do. I think the teams know the plants and know the facilities very well. And Goss and Desai have been part of the Thyssen team for some time. So I think the teams will just get together and, you know, chase the synergies that we've announced. So we've said we'll chase about 400 million euros of synergy and that's going to be their first job.
Sajjan Jindal just walked past, so let me ask you about competition back home in the domestic market. You know, what are you anticipating now in terms of being able to set up this JSW Tata Steel battle?
That's all right. I think competition is always good for the customer and it's good for us, keeps us on our toes. And I think the Indian market is growing. If it's going to be a 200, 300 million ton market, you need more than Tata Steel and JSW Steel. I think it's good for the country to have a few large steel companies. I've always said India is a great place to produce steel, and so we need a strong industry. And I think, you know, we compete with each other. That's good. I think it keeps us on our toes.
Well, speaking of competition and the demand from the Indian steel industry, once again, is that at least for countries where FTAs have been signed, that there should be safeguard duties imposed. Do you still seek more protection?
Well, it depends, you know.
A level playing field, as you like to call it.
Absolutely, we call it that. So let's put it this way, right? I mean, I think India is one of the countries in the world which allows you to come and invest in and build a steel plant. You can have 100% ownership of a steel plant, which not many countries encourage or allow. Even if they allow formally, they don't encourage. India is a country where you can do mining. 100% ownership is allowed in mining as well. So we are happy for people to come and invest in India, build steel plants in India, create jobs in India and compete with us in India. But if you are going to allow people to build steel plants where the interest cost is close to zero and they don't have the legacy costs that we have in terms of trying to build a steel plant, etc., and then you allow them to capitalize on the Indian market at zero import duty, I don't think that's fair to the people investing in India. So that's our point. So I don't think we're looking for protection in that sense. Till 2015, the steel industry never asked for any support, and this steel was always a 0 to 5% import duty product. I don't think there are many products in India where the import duty is 0 to 5% and you have a strong industry which is flourishing. So this industry asked for some support from the government when we felt that other countries were doing things which are not fair to the industry in India. And even if you look at it today, what's happening in Europe or what's happening in the US, I think everyone is first taking care of their own interests. So there's no reason for us to be apologetic if we take care of our interests.
Okay. Since we're talking about demand and we're talking about...
It's been an eventful day, one of the World Economic Forum in Davos. Shireen, in fact, also caught up with Raghuram Rajan earlier, the former RBI governor. Now, Rajan said that during his tenure, he gave the government a scientific process to calculate the excess capital with the central bank. He went on to say that the government did not reject his suggestion but wanted to learn more. Remember, the committee headed by Bimal Jalan has been set up to review the RBI's capital reserve framework, and that panel is set to meet on Monday. Listen in to a slice of Shireen's interview with Rajan.
I'm not sure that there was a formula. There was a process by which we account for capital, which was actually one of the most modern processes, looking at value at risk and how much could be afforded, and what we could therefore transfer to the government. And I think this is something other central banks have picked up. We were asked to make presentations elsewhere. It is something that offers a basis for discussion going forward, and it's something we should think about.
So what was it that you suggested to the government, and what was the response that you got from the government on this?
No, I think the what we had suggested is we need a scientific process by which we evaluate how much capital the RBI needs, and based on that, we declare a dividend. Rather than negotiate this every year around budget time, how much do you need, how much can we spare, et cetera, et cetera. Let's do it on a basis.
Do you believe that that process is arbitrary somewhat?
Well, by its very nature, it's arbitrary because it's based on what you know, the needs of the government are rather than what the RBI needs in terms of maintaining its balance sheet strength and so on. So I would start first by saying here is how much the RBI needs to present a picture of health, because we need a strong central bank. And then anything that is excess should be paid over to the government. It is the government's. The RBI has no call to keep anything that is over and above that. The magic question, of course, is
what is that number? Yeah.
What is that number? And for that, having an objective process of deciding how much that is what Mr. Gandhi was probably referring to. We had a team within the RBI do the calculations, prepare the structure. This splendid young team, which essentially read the latest literature and put it together. And the question is that the basis for proceeding forward? It is state of the art in determining how much capital the RBI needs.
So was that taken forward at all in any form or fashion by the government in your conversations with them?
I think we had a discussion then. We put it on the table. The board at that time approved it in a sense of this is a basis for discussion going forward. The government at that point decided that they needed to learn more. So it wasn't that it was rejected. It was just that we never concluded on that.
All right, on to another special interaction. Niti Aayog CEO Amitabh Kant has said that the government will soon come out with FAME II. That's the second phase of the government's push for faster adoption and manufacturing of hybrid and electric vehicles. In his interview with Shireen at the World Economic Forum in Davos, the Niti Aayog CEO also said that the government will provide subsidy for two-wheeler electric vehicles during the period of FAME II.
On the EV, sir, and this has been something that has been the stated objective of the government, but there's been a lot of back and forth and things haven't, in fact, moved forward. Now, you talked about electrification of two-wheelers, and I understand that that is the big push of the government. There have been meetings even as recently as December and January to try and see how that can be done. But, you know, where do things currently stand? Are you, and you said in the past that you will not make it mandatory for people to transition. So what is the plan and the thinking now?
So a huge amount of work has been done on this. We've come out with green plates. We've come out with new regulations relating to charging. We've pushed for all the petrol pumps to have both charging as well as CNG within their intra-city. We have done away with permits on three-wheelers. So a huge amount of reforms have been done. But I think you'll soon have the FAME II and you'll have a clear roadmap.
When you say soon, sir, we've been waiting for a while now. When will FAME II be unveiled?
I think the Department of Heavy Industry is at its final stages. This is a very large scheme. This is a big one. And we have to be very careful that in the transition period, while we push for EV batteries, it's also important to understand that combustion vehicles in India contribute, automobile manufacturing contributes to 7.2% of India's GDP. It contributes to almost 30 million jobs in India. And therefore, we don't end up disrupting the combustion vehicle industry. We are looking at the additionality of manufacturing. We are looking at the additionality. And, you know, because in India, the additional purchases which will happen in two-wheelers, three-wheelers, and the four-wheelers, and the bus. We are trying to push the buses from a capex model to an opex model. We're pushing for two-wheelers and three-wheelers.
Yeah.
And we are pushing in a manner where states become very key partners of Government of India in this effort.
Is the planned allocation for FAME II going to be larger than what was earlier anticipated?
Substantially larger.
How much?
Quite a big one. I think you'll have to wait for that. Okay. But a big jump forward.
A big jump forward from FAME I.
FAME I.
Okay. And are you going to make it mandatory for a certain percentage of every two-wheeler maker's plans to include a certain percentage of electric vehicles?
Well, what our attempt would be, not mandatory, but our attempt would be that you ensure that the cost of an electric vehicle comes on par with combustion vehicle, at least for two-wheelers and three-wheelers.
So what will the government do to incentivize that?
That would be, as like we've done away with permit, we'll do away with road tax.
Okay.
And we will ensure a certain amount of initial subsidization through the FAME industry. But the challenge there is to bring in size and scale. And that, to my mind, will happen.
So you will subsidize two-wheelers to start with?
Two-wheelers.
For a period of 2 or 3 years?
I think we are looking at the regime of the FAME II. That would be about 2 to 3 years.
Okay.
So that we can get the size and scale. Because without the size and scale, the disruption will not happen.
That's not all from the electric mobility space. GSW Group Sajan Jindal is also betting big on electric vehicles. Talking to Shireen at the World Economic Forum, Sajan Jindal said that the GSW Group is considering the German concept for its electric vehicle foray. In fact, he also said that the company is not very keen to tie up with a Chinese EV manufacturer as it will be difficult to sell Chinese products in India. Listen in to his rationale and his blueprint for the electric vehicle plans.
There's a lot of talk around you tying up with Chinese manufacturers, etc.
No,
what's the story?
No. Chinese, we looked at, because China is very big on EV, and, Tesla kind of stuff cannot work in India. It's too expensive, it's too high-tech. So a Chinese EV is a very good model for India. So we looked at all those cars, and most of every Chinese company wanted to tie up with us. But we are not looking at Chinese, because to sell a Chinese product in India is going to be a very difficult thing. And last, coming from a JSW saddle. So we are looking at a German concept,
okay. And
technology would come from Germany and or Austria, and that we would be doing it 100% JSW.
And manufacturing in India?
Of course, 100%.
Okay, so what is going to be the positioning of this electric vehicle, and when do we actually see it being commercialized? Because, even companies like Mahindra, who've had the first mover advantage, continue to struggle in the Indian market.
No, I think there is still time for the electric vehicle to come into India, and because we don't have the infrastructure, still the technology is still developing. Because when you come with the product, it must match the IC engine technology.
Yeah.
It must have that same acceleration. It must
and range.
Yeah. So that's why we believe that in 2 to 3 years the batteries will become very cheap. And the range will increase a lot, and I don't really worry about the infrastructure, because India, I always believe that India is a very, very different kind of a country, where the infrastructure will come as the product gets launched. For example, the aircrafts came before the airports were built in India, in the sense that, and today we see Bombay, we are roaming around for half an hour congestion.
Yeah.
So now new airport is being expedited, and new highways are being built, so that would happen.
So this is a serious plan?
No, absolutely serious. It will happen.
How much money are you putting?
Money in excess of $1 billion.
Okay, $1 billion probably going into GSW's EV plans. Moving on to IT, the partial shutdown of the US government has not impacted Infosys's American business so far. That's the word coming in from Salil Parekh, the CEO and MD of Infosys. He, however, added that if the stalemate is left unaddressed for too long, it could have some downstream impact. Here is what he had to say.
So far, we've actually not seen any impact on our business. Mm. About 60% of our business comes from the US.
Mm.
And we've had good growth. We announced our results just a few days ago for the last quarter. A strong growth in the US, strong growth in financial services across all of the sectors.
Mm.
Of course, the work that's going on within the US and the concern with the slowdown, with the shutdown, will result in some impact downstream if it's not addressed at one stage.
And perhaps the concern is it's coming at a time where it's late stage growth in the United States. People are worried that perhaps there won't be an infrastructure plan because of the stalemate in Washington. As it pertains to your business going forward, are you already seeing any waning confidence from U.S. corporates, any dip in demand for your business services?
Again, we've not seen any dip in demand.
Yeah.
Of course, this has been a long growth cycle. With the shutdown and with some other activities globally, there's some concern that this could start to slow down. There's talk about it, but in real demand terms, there's no real impact.
Is that true globally for your business as well?
Also, so our European business actually grew faster than our US business in the last quarter, and that's going well. Asia Pacific, for us, mainly Australia and Japan, that also grew nicely.
Okay.
So all of those at this stage seem to be okay.
And that was, in fact, Salil Parekh's first television interview after taking over as the CEO of the company, almost a year after he took over. Here's a very short break, though, on that note. On the other side, CRISIL downgrades non-convertible debentures of Island FS subsidiary Jharkhand Road Projects. Once again, this and more on the other side. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. fact, ratings agency CRISIL has downgraded the bonds issued by the Jharkhand Road Projects Implementation Company to junk. This, in turn, increase the anxiety of bankers and mutual funds. In fact, ICRA has put six mutual fund schemes with exposure under watch. Lata Venkatesh is here to tell us just why. Lata, what do these downgrades really mean for banks and mutual fund investors?
Yes, CRISIL has downgraded the debentures issued by Jharkhand Road Implementing Company, which is an SPV, a totally owned subsidiary of ILNFS Transportation Network, which is a group company of ILNFS. This whole thing has happened, this downgrade has happened because Jharkhand Road Company told its trustee not to pay dividend from the escrow account. And why did it do that? Because on October 15, 2018, when the NCLAT passed an interim order, it ordered a moratorium. Don't pay any interest amounts on all the subsidiaries until the restructuring of the parent company and the group company's loans are done. And hence, even the SPVs are not able to pay, although they have enough money and their amounts are escrowed. In a domino effect, rating agency ICRA has put under rating watch debt funds of three asset management companies, three mutual funds, that's HDFC AMC, UTI AMC, and Birla Sun Life AMC. The expectation is that the problem is temporary, that as soon as restructuring of the entire ALFS group is done, these SPVs will be allowed to respect their loans and pay out the dividends. It is seen as a temporary pain as of now, and that's why we have not seen too much of chaos in the financial system. Additionally, of course, the government is also planning to request Reserve Bank not to demand provisioning against those loans which will turn bad, because the solution is expected in a few months. But we will have to really wait and see how the solution works.
Okay, Lada, thanks for that. Now, the Corporate Affairs Ministry, meanwhile, has identified a few ILNFS subsidiaries which have ample funds in their escrow account but are unable to service debt. And now we learn that the ministry is likely to approach the Reserve Bank of India seeking deferment of provisioning for these very companies. But on to the big political story of the day. Amit Shah kick-started the BJP's election campaign in Bengal today, addressing a rally at Malda. Shah promised to uproot the Mamata Banerjee government from Bengal. That's not all. He also mocked the recently held opposition rally in Kolkata, calling the Mahagathbandhan an alliance of greed and dishonesty. Trinamool, meanwhile, hit back at Shah. Party MP Derek O'Brien said that the BJP was nervous and scared ahead of polls.
ये सत्ता और स्वार्थ का गठबंधन की रैली में भारत माता की जय का जयकारा नहीं लगता है, वंदे मातरम के नारे नहीं लगते हैं, क्या देश का आप भला करोगे आप बताओ? हम चाहते हैं गरीबी हटाओ, वो चाहते हैं मोदी हटाओ.
After listening to the BJP president's speech in Malda, it's quite obvious that the BJP are nervous, poor in taste, and low on facts. They don't understand the ethos and the culture of Bengal.
And we will take that and a lot of other stories forward in India Business Hour, but completely out of time on this edition of What's Hot. Thank you for watching. Up next, Nifty held on to the 10,900 mark today, while Sensex ended with cuts of about 2/5%. Markets today, top pack takes all the action forward on the other side. Stay right there.